I am joined by Joan Tufts and Diane Bulger, who will discuss the practical ways in which our faith community is trying to respond to the needs for care and companionship through volunteerism. They will explore some of the challenges in motivating and supporting those who volunteer. Joan will share with us what it means to reach out to those who are sick and dying. Diane will focus on the specific examples of best practices. Together, they will help us understand what it means to reach out to people who are sick and dying.
Hi, Joan.
Hi, Diane.
It's so wonderful to have this opportunity for us to share.
It is.
Joan, could you share in brief your personal experiences of when your husband, Deacon Gerald, reached out to people who were sick and dying? How did you respond to their needs?
When Gerald was active in his ministry, he was often asked to visit the sick and the dying in their homes. I would accompany him, and I would visit, while he was visiting with the sick and the dying, I would visit with the companion. Usually it was the spouse. It was significant to both of us in very early on in our visits that there was a need in the parish community for a service such as this. We didn't have a name for it, but we felt that this was one of the things that his ministry was the ministry of families, and it was certainly part of this ministry. So I was really helping, or trying, feeling that I was helping anyway, to diminish the fears, the guilt, and the loneliness of the companions while they journey in this end of life episode in their lives. So this was one of the things that we thought was significant to do. Oftentimes I was asked to pray with the companion. Many times they wanted me to say the rosary with them, or even to bring them to Mass. So we really felt that this was a need at that time.
That's wonderful. Your husband passed away last December. How were his palliative care experiences and the support that both of you received from your pastor, your community, from the nurses, doctors, and the palliative care team?
Yes, Gerald passed away December 17. His struggle with cancer ended. And as difficult as it was to let him go, the family and I are grateful that he died a good death. The support of the parish community, the clergy, gave us the strength the children and I needed to accept our loss. The team, the medical team, the palliative care team in the hospital, the medical team here in Halifax and in Yarmouth was great. But there were challenges. And the challenges came from being in a rural community where the district is very, very large. And oftentimes, the VON could not come on a daily basis. He was assigned for a daily visit, but it could not happen. The palliative care nurse that was assigned to him has a large district. The caseload is unbelievably large. So oftentimes she would call. His cancer had metastasized in his trachea. He couldn't speak every day. So many times he couldn't talk to her on the phone. So there was a lack of communication there with her. The palliative care doctor in the Yarmouth Hospital is there part-time. So oftentimes he was not available. We were fortunate in our family because I have two brother-in-laws who are doctors. One of them is a palliative care physician. I have an oncology sister-in-law who's an oncology nurse. And my sister is a social worker in the palliative care unit in Yarmouth. So these were the people that I connected with to get a good understanding of the medical reports, what was expected, what was to come. As I say, I was very fortunate for that. I can relate to the companion being lonely, because during I shared everything. And I did not want to share the extent of my fear with him. So I kept that to myself. I remember one time a parishioner came and I shared with him the fact that I couldn't pray anymore. I didn't know what to ask God for. And I had a lot of guilt. And he reassured me that I didn't have to. That God, you know, that people were praying for me and God was listening to my thoughts. And that's when I learned a very important lesson, is that I can be still and I know that it is God. So that was really something that I want to share with other people as well. You don't have to, if you can't pray, somebody else is praying for you. Gerald's struggle was very difficult to watch, and oftentimes I was referred to as his nurse. I didn't want to be his nurse. I wanted to be his wife, taking care of her sick husband.
Thank you for sharing that. That was a beautiful sharing. I understand that you are interested in starting a ministry of care and companionship in your parish community. I believe wherever there's a need, there is a ministry. Jesus is there to guide you. Where is he guiding you now?
Having experienced the visits that Gerald and I did in our community with the sick and the dying, it gave me a desire to serve a ministry. I didn't know there was a ministry at that time, but it gave me that desire to serve. And in February of 2016, this year, Deacon Bob Britton came to me and asked me if I would sit on the Ministry of Care and Companionship. And I truly believe it was a calling. And it gave me the desire to continue this ministry, or this work. So I've approached all the priests, all the coordinators in the Clare area. I submitted a proposal up to them and asked them if we could not start a ministry. And I'm happy to report that this is happening. In January, I'm hoping that there will be training for the volunteers. The coordinators and I sat together. We had a list of names of people who we thought were called to this ministry. They all accepted. And it's exciting to see that this is actually becoming a dream come true in our area. We hope to launch it at Easter time, and I am truly a believer that with the Holy Spirit as my GPS, this will happen.
It's so exciting. Good to hear.
So, having said that, Diane, could you give me a brief outline of how you became involved in the Ministry of Care and Companionship? And how long has this been active, this ministry has been active in your parish?
Well, 33 years ago, my Uncle Spark was dying. And I kept hearing about this nun that was visiting him. The whole family was very happy to have her. On the day of Spark's funeral, I met this wonderful nun. And as she walked away, I kept thinking how wonderful it was that the Catholic Church reached out with such love and compassion. I did not catch her name. However, I never forgot that she was a messenger of God's love. 12 years later, I was very active in parish ministry. And I started to notice that there were people missing from the parish, that some families had no longer, were no longer attending. And I pondered why. There had been a death in some of those families. And it made me wonder how the church had responded. Did we reach out to them? It was at that time that I realized the need for the parish to reach out to people who were sick, lonely, dying, and bereaved. How many times have you heard someone say that no one from the church visited? I was trained as a palliative care volunteer in 1998 and soon started working in a nursing home doing recreation program on the Alzheimer Dementia Care Unit. And while I was there, I realized the loneliness, that many people did not have someone to visit them. There was one gentleman there who was living with Alzheimer's, and he said to me one day, he says, "I know what you are." And he took him about 30 seconds to find the words, and he said, "You are real company." And for me, that was an aha moment. He identified exactly what I wanted to be. Often I would stay after work when there was somebody who was dying, and I wondered why no one from the church visited. I believe that every parish should have a ministry of care and companionship to journey with people and express God's love. The Ministry of Care and Companionship at St. Vincent de Paul started in November 2008 with the commissioning of 13 palliative care trained volunteers. We first started with the palliative care visiting and then realized the need for companion care as well. So the volunteers are trained for both.
So Diane, how does one prepare to become a volunteer in this ministry? And what are the qualifications that a leader would look for in a volunteer?
Okay. Well, when we advertise for volunteers to join the ministry, we are looking for people who are mature, compassionate, kind, trustworthy, good listeners, faith-filled, and with a willingness to commit their time. A palliative care volunteer would offer comfort and emotional, spiritual support to those who are nearing the end of their life. I also look for their personal experiences that would enhance the ministry. Someone who has lost a loved one would be better prepared to journey with somebody who is dying and to support the caregiver. A two-day certified hospice palliative care course is provided with parish ministry in mind. We use the new Canadian Hospice Palliative Care Volunteer Training Manual, as well as the Provincial Hospice Palliative Care Training Manual. The focus of the parish ministry is to have a good understanding of hospice palliative care and the guiding principles of hospice palliative care. I am grateful to Mary Wild and Sister Nuala Kenny, also known as Dr. Kenny, and Susan Duggan, who is a retired palliative care nurse and is very much involved in grief support. These three women are instrumental in providing the training for the parish ministry. With the parish-based ministry, the volunteer's commitment is with the parish and the community. At St. Vincent de Paul Parish, we have a relationship with Bissex Court Nursing Home. There is a huge need for one-on-one visits there. The ministry does both companion and palliative care visiting. We have found it important to get to know people earlier, to form a relationship, so then when they are palliative, we are already present in their lives. We also visit people in their personal homes. One of the greatest challenges in reaching out to people in the parish community, and I believe this is the situation with most parishes, is finding out who is in need of a visit. This is when the church plays, everyone in the church plays a role by reaching out and letting the person know that there are people that would visit them. And also they could maybe ask the person if it's okay to give their name to the parish. We meet people where they are in their journey. Sometimes people will ask for us to pray with them and for them. And sometimes people are not comfortable with prayer at all. So we pray silently in our hearts. Prayer is essential to all that we do for God. We also form a palliative care team approach, and we'll do a vigil when a person is nearing the end of life. When a parishioner wants to join the ministry, there is a discernment process. The first step is to complete an application form and do an interview. During the interview, they get to ask questions. I look for a time commitment of 2 to 4 hours a week. And for companion care, I look for companion care visitors as well. And I look for a commitment of 1 to 2 hours. They visit people who are sick and lonely.
So, Diane, I understand your position in the Ministry of Care and Companionship is the role of the leader. Could you give us an outline of the responsibilities of that leader?
Certainly. The ministry leader is responsible for ensuring the volunteers are trained and prepared for visiting. The leader assesses how the ministry can best respond to the individual and matching up the person with the right volunteer, and follows up with the volunteers to see how they're doing. The leader ensures that the pastor is informed when a person requests to see a priest, and that he knows who is being visited. The leader should have an awareness of some of the challenges that the church faces, like euthanasia and assisted suicide. The leader needs to enhance their knowledge on a regular basis and arranges for training and inspirational speakers for the volunteers. Some topics would be grief and bereavement, communication, the do's and don'ts, and spirituality issues. The leader develops relationships with local nursing homes and hospitals and community-based programs, and prepares the ministry meetings and ministry retreats. As a parish ministry, having retreats and a time for prayer is essential for growing in our relationship with Jesus. Volunteers who give lovingly in the name of Jesus also rely on Him to nourish their souls. If a parish wants to start a ministry of care and companionship, it is essential for the success of the ministry to have a leader identified who will lead and coordinate the ministry. I know from my own experience that there are many people out there who would love to visit people who are sick and lonely and dying. They just need a leader to make the invitation to join the ministry. The Diocese of Ministry of Care and Companionship are working on providing a resource page on the website for parishes who wish to start a ministry of care and companionship. The information provided will be very helpful to pastors, to leaders, and caregivers. You would be able to find resources to guide you in starting a ministry of care and companionship.
Thank you, Diane. This is certainly helpful to me, who is starting a new ministry, hopefully, in our community. I need to ask you one more question. Okay. Who did you ever find out the name of the nun?
Yes, her name is Sister Joan O'Keefe, a Sister of Charity. God works in mysterious ways. One person can make a difference by journeying with a person. My Uncle Spark looked forward to Sister Joan's visits. She became someone he could talk to, that he could trust and even laugh with. She was a true witness of God's love.
Thank you.
Thank you, Diane and Joan, for your insight and compassion. It is clear to me that you are committed to this ministry of care and companionship, both in your home parish and throughout the Archdiocese. We'll ask you to gather in your groups once again and to consider the following questions. Have you had an experience attending to a family member or a friend who was sick or dying? Do you feel that there is a need in your parish to organize an outreach program for the sick and dying? Can you identify and list some of the key elements you feel are essential in establishing a ministry? For example, identifying volunteers, developing training packages, other resources that would help reach out to those in need.